everyone. Once again, before you, we congratulate Abhilash. Although many times we have congratulated. This is how success speaks itself. No. The way we say at times, paisa bolta hai, success bolta hai. Isn't it? Anyhow, certainly he will discuss more than what I can tell. I'll be telling later on throughout our other programs. But optional public administration or any optional, this is what we say to any candidate, is like religion. You should prepare it in that fashion. You cannot have any kind of shortcut in optional. You can find shortcut, no doubt, in some context, but unless you have a thorough preparation, there is no, let's say that, any chance. There is one chance by chance. Right. Some people certainly may qualify by chance.
Right.
Shortcut also, but that does not work always. This you know that, we don't have to go into those aspects. So, it requires very systematic efforts with patience and continuity. Still, some people may not qualify. This is the bitter truth. Even if many people apply efforts, they may be equally thorough, they may be equally good, but still it happens that in that year, that person may not qualify. Again, we will not talk those things, right? Because we will talk on success side, right? Not on failure side, because you have to become success. You have to get success, so this is how it is. Why South Africa was eliminated is not the matter. How Pakistan won, that is a matter of talk. Right. So analysis is on Pakistan team, how they did it. Irrespective of past years, they were highly erratic. But after winning that, let's say, series or championship, what analysis you get in newspaper? How they did it. Right. If you read 4 or 5 days back, 6 days back, 1 week back newspaper, there will be any analysis. So, this is how a person does it, it becomes matter of analysis, and other teams will certainly learn from that inconsistent team, since it has won. Isn't it? So, this is how the success, let's say that, we learn from, because certainly there are many elements that you can learn from success, no doubt also from failures. So, optional, this especially public administration, lots of let's say that uncertainties remain, especially in 2013-14, to some extent in 15, but that has changed in 16. Right. Unshackling of this optional you can find to some extent, because now it has also a level playing field with other optional. In fact, in some cases, so it has done better than other optional. As far as you get average marks in public administration. So, to this year, there are many people who may have 260, 70, 80s, 90s. Many people you can find. Which last year, if you say, so 267 was highest in public administration. Ashwini Pandey. Right. So 267 was highest. Many people sitting here even may have, I guess, 267. Right, but you know what it is. Right. This year it is different, it is 2017, right, backed by 2016. 2017 can be different. Right. Even this is what we are saying, 334 may be again, it may be not a good score in 2017. It depends on UPSC, or again 267 can be one of the highest, 2017. These are all, let's say, uncertainties, which certainly affect your morale, confidence, etc. But certainly it should not affect your level of efforts. Your morale may be affected, no doubt. Your confidence may be affected, but your level of effort should not be affected. Because you don't know when, what is going to happen. What UPSC is going to do. So there should be continuous efforts. And this is how, let's say that case, not in all cases, but in some cases it will pay. If 100 people are applying efforts, so certainly some people will benefit. And this is how the competition trained, let's say that all people will not qualify, you have limited number of seats already. So you have to find your way. That is how the motivation. So he will take up some of the things and he will share all those things. And he, let's say that not only he, there are many other people who certainly are in list, also not in list. They have also applied efforts. And that was a very continuous effort throughout those uncertainties in 13 and 14 and 15 as well. This is how. And there was always also a talk whether we should continue with this optional. Some people also, let's say that decide, at least I know one, two persons who decide to quit optional, opt for new optional. It happens in other optional also. If philosophy is not doing well, so whether we are going to quit philosophy. Is it right decision? Only result will tell. If result is there, it is right decision. No result, wrong decision. No. Herbert Simon, this is how. So he will say all these things. Decision making. But let's say that once you take a decision, I think you should stand by that decision. This is how it is. In any optional, you have to apply effort. It's not if you have anthropology, so yes, they have cakewalk and catwalk, and this is how they will get. Isn't it? Many your friends may have anthropology. It is not that all anthropology people have optional, so they have got rank. Isn't it? It's not like that. So that should not be in the mind. I don't think that once you take optional, so it should not be in your mind, right? That level of fluctuations, whether I should take different optional, especially by the time you appear in main examination. Right? After main examination, you can decide. But if any person has that kind of thinking and fluctuation or a bit of, let's say, less confidence, so he should not have by the time he is appearing in main examination. Because simply you should take, let's take this chance and appear, apply all the efforts, and it can happen, because this is how it is happening with all the people, those who are securing marks. Rather you should try, many a time people try to, let's say that, pick up those things which are not part of this examination or which should not be the part of his strategy. Negative things. So many a time, let's say we take negative things and we are busy with those negative things. UPSC is like this. Examination like this. There is uncertainty. Optionally like this. I have done everything. I have read all books. Maine unke yahan bhi kar liya, inke yahan bhi kar liya. Kuch nahi hua. Sara ye funda hai. It is not your task, let's say that. Then you become a critic. Read. Then you should become a critic, not one aspirant. This is how. Because you are barking a wrong tree, this is how I can say that. You should be a student. You should not be a critic. Otherwise, again, you are wasting your time. Read. Many people divert their all these, let's say, focus, their attention, because of all these things. Read. Your task should be to be a student. This is the paper. I have to write this test. Even there are people, let's say that, they will say, kaisa question aa gaya? You are not supposed to be examiner. You are supposed to be a student. You write that question. Simple. Agar kisi ne question diya hai, so he may have something in mind. But you should not think in that fashion. Why this question has been given? This is not your task. Yes, you can debate ki yes, ye question theek hai, nahi hai, that's all. But you should not say why he has asked this question. Then again, it is not, let's say you are wasting your time. It will not benefit. Right. Rather, let's say what we are saying is that there should be simple, let's say that ki you focus, ki I have to ensure, guarantee in this optional, let's say decent marks. And I have to apply those all efforts, the positive things. Right, which will make you improve. No doubt there should be certain critical thinking, but it should not get diverted, converted into critic. Second thing is, let's say, consistency. We don't find, very few people have consistency. Right, people do not have consistency, let's say that. People start and somehow consistency is lost midway. Right, you get diverted, you are not able to follow, you do not have all those continuity, etc. You don't write tests, you don't join classes, you don't attend classes, you don't even study at home regularly. This is all these things happen. Right, see, result, outcome, you see, right, in the end of the training program. Right, in the end of the 2.5 months, you cannot see the result in beginning. You cannot see the result meanwhile when you are applying your efforts. Suppose there is a training program for 5 days. So after 5 days, you need to know the outcome. What is the outcome? Right. Rather than you get the outcome within that. This should not be the approach. I'm indirectly trying to say many things, not I'm trying to be very explicit. Right. Simply what we want is that you should be very focused. And those all, let's say, negative stimuli should not divert, disperse your attention. And then you can apply and get certain, let's say, that good hold in optional, be it any optional. Right. Since optionals are based on theory, concepts, etc., which you can understand. And there should be right understanding. Many people may have wrong understanding. Once you have a wrong understanding, there is no chance. So it's not about GS, whether you know how many topics. Right. Any optional is about concept and theory, and whether you have a right kind of understanding on those theories and concepts. Right. If you do not have right understanding, so long as you don't have, you have to study. There is no other option. Whether you have to study Prasad and Prasad 20 times, you should. Great. You cannot say ki Prasad se to question aata nahi hai. At least by 2016 examination now you cannot say. Great. So Prasad and Prasad or Mohit Bhattacharya or whatever the books, let's say that. You cannot say that ki no question nahi aata hai. I have read once, twice, thrice. That is not the issue. The issue is whether you understand if it is what exactly is logical positivism. Do you understand this? What exactly the difference between normative and descriptive approach? What exactly is, let's say, inductive, deductive approach? What exactly is, let's say, that when Simon says about positivism, or when he divides decision-making premises, fact and value premises, can you explain it with some examples related to government policies, programs, incidents? Right. If you can explain it with some examples, this is called clear knowledge. This is called, let's say that, conceptual clarity. Right. If you are not, if you simply know decision making, if simply know satisficing, if simply know new public administration, so that is not going to do. Now, whether you are able to create, generate your own examples, whether you can relate yourself, one somebody else can say, one somebody, any book can refer, right? In class you can get, in notes you can get, and some of them you can certainly memorize. But they will not always work. Right? Isn't it? So that requires very sharp knowledge. Taylor is controversial, popular as well as controversial. Right? This is how. What exactly you are writing on his popularity? And what exactly you are writing on Controversial. Controversial and criticism, both are different. Are you taking both criticism and weaknesses? Do you understand difference between criticism and weaknesses? Both are not the same. In controversial aspect, whether you are mindlessly writing all the criticisms, you are not writing controversy. You are writing criticism. You are writing weaknesses. No, and you will come and say, "Humne to pura prasad and prasad likh diya." Means pura notes likh diya. Ya jo aapne bataya tha, sara likh diya. This is not the point. There are, even if simple questions they ask, but still it is our experience that exactly same thing is not written by candidates. Very few candidates are there who can write those exactly same. Other people simple write generic answer. General. All general criticism written. Or general popularity written. Read. And this is how it is not going to work. Even if then paper was simple, 2016, but it does not make any difference, no, in result. You cannot say ki all people in public administration, so they have qualified. Isn't it? The grievances remain same. Number of people not qualifying remain same, more or less. It's not ki paper was simple, so result has been disproportionate. No, all public and optional people have qualified. Aisa to hua nahi. The paper simple hai ya difficult hai, usse to on the outcome pe to koi fark nahi pad raha. Right? Chahe wo 267 hai ya 334 hai, wo to highest hi hai. Right? 200 bhi aake highest ho sakta hai. Right? So on the whole, let's say that ki outcome in this examination, it is not changing much. It means, let's say that if paper is simple or difficult, your challenge is same. Challenge is same. Even a person getting to last year 220 or 30s, he may be happy. Because if you see from last year perspective, it was a good score. But if you take this year and he has 270, so he cannot say that, no, it is better one. Because he would like that it should have been 300. And he should have qualified. So, this is why we are saying that even one thing can help. Dekho, success ke liye koi ek aise cheez ki zarurat hai that can be making you converting that into failure to success. Any one factor. It can be very small factor, it can be very big factor, which makes difference between his answer and his answer. Knowledge level people may have same. You may have same knowledge. There can be some, let's say, incremental difference. Not ki, yes, 1% has a huge knowledge, 1% has no knowledge. At least those people who are writing main examination, majority of people may carry more or less same knowledge. This is how I will be saying. Difference is when you write, and when you write, so there are different things that you write. So this is what all about. Again, it is endless to talk all these things. Now Abhilash will tell you some of the things which you can learn, which could have a work in his favor. So he'll share some of the things related to this optional. So I'll finish here.
I started giving my attempts in 2013. For the first time, when I wrote public administration paper in 2013, I thought I had a decent preparation, but not a good one. I got total 155 marks. The breakup was 47 plus 108. So I jokingly thought that in paper one I had used refills worth more than marks I had got. 47 was so much low marks in that paper. But then I realized that my understanding was not good. I was not able to comprehend many of the questions that were asked. Then I came to Lukmaan IAS and particularly to Sir, and then the journey from there started getting better in terms of public administration performance. In 2014, I got 249, 100 plus 139. Then in 15, I got 242, 100 plus 142. And in this year, I got as many marks as has been told by Sir. The breakup remains 166 plus 168. So this was the public administration journey of UPSC. But after 2013, I realized one thing, especially when I came to Sir's class and once Sir started teaching public administration, that if we ask, many of us would be able to tell us, like simply if we ask, what are the Taylor's principles? All of us who have public administration will be able to tell us what are their principles if we ask them directly. But if we twist the questions and somehow ask a question in which Taylor's concepts is to be applied, then it becomes a challenge. Maybe we have to write the same thing in a different manner, but that answering that question requires a sort of understanding, clear understanding of Taylor's principles and its application. So, especially in papers of 2014 and 15, this was the case. Many questions were asked. They were looking like a complex question. They were difficult. There were also many difficult questions, but they were application based. Whatever we have read, whatever thinkers we have read, whatever concepts we have read, especially in paper 1 and in paper 2, so they were to be applied. And application can only happen if we are clear about the concepts. As Sir said, I was rarely able to tell any of the concepts, logical positivism and normativism, description clearly before I joined Sir classes. So that is the thing. Once I joined and started focusing on these concepts, started clarifying different topics mentioned in our syllabus, so it helped. I was able to comprehend the question in a better way and present my answers in a proper fashion. So this is how I'll say, whatever you study it very properly. Whatever be the concept you are study it very properly. Many people, in fact, we also say, we are also a big critic of UPSC, Sir, was saying, we also used to say, Sir, ye kya pooch liya hai, nahi samajh mein aa raha hai. But see, when my group and we were preparing public administration, we started reading Mohit Bhattacharya many times, Prasad and Prasad many times. We found many of the questions of 2014 and 15 were verbatim from there. I thought, how this question of comparative performance has come in paper of 2015. It was verbatim quoted, 2013, it was verbatim quoted from Prasad and Prasad. It's just how we read our book. We tend to ignore that this is not a thing, but the books of public administration, especially Prasad and Prasad, Mohit Bhattacharya, are like these, that every line can become a question. So we need to read it very precisely and very carefully, so that we don't ignore any of the lines, because verbatim it is quoted there and you need to explain. Now if we can recall that we have read these lines somewhere in our preparation, we'll be able to answer it. The only difference is when we ignore it, we'll say from where it has come. Though it can happen with other questions, but the questions which are from the book, that we can afford to answer. So this is the thing. When we read our basic books, most of us read the same books for public administration. I think you all be knowing the basic books that we read for public administration. Mohit Bhattacharya books, Prasad and Prasad thinkers. Apart from that, I consulted extensively Sir's notes, and Sir also provides public administration material, 4-volume. So I consulted some of the topics from there also, which I thought were not covered in the book properly. So this was my source to start with, this for Mohit Bhattacharya books. There are 4 books of Mohit Bhattacharya: Social Origins, Development Dynamics, Development Perspective, Social Development Perspective, then Restructuring Public Administration, and this 4th one, as recent one, has come, A New Look into the something like this is the topic. You don't need to read page by page all the books. Just whenever you read a topic from your syllabus, like if say Sir teaches a topic, go and read that portion from the book. Because once Sir teaches a particular topic, you are already very clear of the topic, and if you read it from the book and revise it, it gives you a greater clarity. And probably will be, because the questions which are asked are actually the type of statements that are given in the book. the type of wordings, the type of literature that they use is pretty much the same that that has been used by books of Mohit Bhattacharya or, for example, Ravi Prasad and Prasad. That is why they quote from there. So many questions come from there. So read the books. I'll say definitely read the books apart from search notes. Another thing is with regard to public administration is that whenever we are, this is true for entire syllabus of the UPSC, but particularly for public administration, I have seen, I have learnt it from sir, that for example, sir is teaching a particular syllabus in the topic, be it thinker or be it any other thing. So, because this, whatever we study in class is a kind of dialogue. Most of the coaching, I have attended some other of them, there is a monologue, teacher speaks for us and we listen to it. But when sir teaches public administration, there is a kind of dialogue. Sir will immediately ask question. Now you start thinking. And sir, when sir will teach a particular topic, say NPA or a thinker, he will immediately relate it to the current happenings, whatever is in the news. So you get a habit that, okay, you can also do it. Whenever you read a concept, such should be the clarity that you can relate it to the contemporary happenings. As sir was saying, can you relate fact value paradigm to a current example? Can you relate to the Taylor's formula, Taylor's principles to current happenings? And we will find that if we read it very properly, we can. Because Taylor's relevance exists today, for example, and many of the reforms that government is trying to bring in is similar to what Taylor said. So you can relate it in that fashion. And similarly for other thinkers and topics. For example, if we are, if government is like, we are talking about performance linked pay, and we can find some sort of principle in FEOL, incentivization. So we can always link that. Fayol also talked about this this thing, initiative and incentive, and we can link it to the current happenings. So just to it will, what impact it will have, it will give the examiner a clear direction that this student has got the grasp over his concepts and is relating it to the contemporary happenings. And I think if we present a very good example in public administration papers relating it to whatever is happening today to the practical administration down the ground, really helps improving your marks. Because if I nothing special I did, this is the writing, is the writing skill that sir helped me improve, and by incorporating the examples like these may have helped me this time. Apart from it, the thing is that many a times we think how to write public administration answers, and because the questions itself are so complex, leaving aside this year paper, we all must have seen it, this was on the easier side compared to earlier papers. But whenever we are writing, I'll repeat what's because this is what sir told us, that see, if there are 250 marks questions, we always used to crib about, including me and people who I have prepared with, that okay, this much of question was out of the syllabus. But sir said to us that okay, let us believe that you are true, 70 marks questions were out of the syllabus, let us agree to it, but the remaining 180 marks were from the syllabus. What justice have we done to these questions? Have we written them in a very proper way so that we can extract maximum marks out of this 180 marks? Because that we know, we are claiming that we know 180 marks. We should write those questions very properly. And for the remaining 80 marks, we can write something or some part of the question that we understand, or some general things just to fill up the pages so that we can get some grace marks. If we follow that strategy for a tough paper, I think it can work. I got decent enough marks, not the highest, but 240 was I think on the better side of marks in paper of 15 and 16, because such was the trend in public administration in those years. So always focus on the questions you know in the examination, prioritize them, and then answer them. What I used to do.
See, basically, there are many things that we are bothered, and we are bothered about those things which have no any relevance. Like the question he is saying, what you carry forward in your mind, the question which is most difficult. I was not able to do this. But do you think that matters? It does not. You are again barking a wrong tree. many people come and bring a difficult question and they say, sir, iska answer kya hoga? I say, I don't know. And I will not try to know. I say very openly and rudely also. I say emphatically, I will not try to know this question. Why? It will not be repeated. So why I should know? And why you should know? And every year they will ask some questions which are new. I am not a academician that I have a quest to get all those knowledge. Right. I want to only teach for this competitive examination. Academician can have that quest to know each and everything. But you should not. There are some questions every year they will ask. This cannot be avoided. And some students always carry forward that thing. Right. I do not know this question. What is the answer? Why are you trying to know that question? Right. What are you doing of 200 marks? What are you doing of 230 marks? What are you doing even 180 marks? Right. A simple question whether you are able to write answer. It is our experience that people do not write best answer of the most easy question in the paper. This is our experience. And you are taking one question which you do not know, you say your result did not happen because of that. Yesterday we had one session, somebody told, I was not able, he was meeting outside, so he told, I was not able to refer ARCs again. I told, it is not needed. And that is not the reason that you have not qualified or secured marks. There are many people who do not read ARCs again, still they have qualified. So these things are not the points, let's say that. You have to focus the major aspect, right? Still you analyze and there are many questions you know much better. What are you doing in that? This is how it is. So we'll continue. Yes.
If we have a look at the question paper, we all know there are 5 questions. First and fifth one is the compulsory, then we need to choose another 3, at least one from each section. So now in public administration, especially till last year and to some extent this year, there is always a challenge to choose questions, because sometimes it is 15 marks or 20 10 marks in paper 2. Now what is the, there can be 2 ways. I can choose a question in which I may know all the 3 parts, or I may choose a question in which I may know 2 of the parts in a far better manner. And one part I may not know or know in a little bit, say I can but just only write something. What we decided, by we I mean the group in which I prepared, that we will choose the questions, for example, the questions in some cases, in the 2 of which we know better. Because going with by the logic what sir was telling and I was also telling, that it will help you fetch more marks. For example, if I write average 50 marks, average answer for 50 marks, and if I write better answers for 35 marks and average for 15 marks, common sense says that second one will fetch more marks. So this can be a technique of choosing your questions the answer of which you will like to write, you know, in paper. Because we tend to think that we should write all the questions. It is true we should write all the questions, but at least some of the questions we should write in a very good manner, so that it increases our chances of getting more marks. So try to choose those questions which you can write your best answer, in which you can write your best answer. If you choose 5 to 6 questions like that, I believe that you'll get more marks if you write compared to the case you write average answers for all of them. Even if you'll write, say, get low marks for 15 number, but you'll get greater marks in the remaining 35 numbers. So this was my what sir used to tell us. According to that we plan our strategy of choosing questions. You can have your own. I think it was a good thing, sir. I don't know
whether. See, basically, when if you see 2016 paper, so there will be difficulty in selecting the 3 questions, the optional questions, because there can be possibility that you know equally well 2 questions. When you know in one section 2 questions equally well, then it becomes very difficult for you which question I should decide. And it will happen again if the paper comes in the same standard. Your question you should decide. I will make it more clear what he is saying, that the answers which you can write very specific. So the questions where you have some specificity, that questions you should select. You should not select a generic question which is very, let's say that you understand very well. You should select those options where there are certain specific things they have asked. That will make you write a very specific answer rather than a question which is general and simple. Right. So this is how, let's say that NPA is a reinvention or first reinvention of the government. So it is a general question. But comment on the NPA 5 goals and anti goals. It is very specific question. So the same, let's say that if you say NPA is the reinvention or first reinvention of the government, so it is a general question. You have to justify case it is first reinvention. Right. But if it is asked is comment on the anti goals and goals of NPA, so these are very specific goals, they are very specific. The 5 goals and anti goals you have to write. This is how the selection strategy should be. And when you write a specific question, so this you can write better than that generic one. Right. So this way you should try to select.
I'll give you an example. If you have this 2016 paper, I was confused after I decided to attempt the first and the second question, section A, and I was confused between question number 3 and 4, because question number 3 was a very general question. It had all the statements and we can afford to write all the questions. There was nothing as such that we will not be able to write those questions. Question number 4C, I was not clear. Again, it was a very general question. But for question 4A and 4B, these are very specific questions. It directly Blake and Morton theory, for which I could also reproduce a diagram there. I can very well explain that because it is an objective topic. And for topic 2, bureau shipping model, it is also a very clear topic, was taught by sir in the class also. So for these two questions, I was sure that these 35 marks I can write in a very proper fashion. I can write best answers in these two. And for the third, I will write some general thing related to the current happening. Give an example, so I'll fetch a average kind of marks. So I thought fourth question would be a better choice than 3. So this can be an approach. Again, I like to take some examples of questions from question paper. Sir was talking about a particular question. I am referring to that only. Taylorism is considered very controversial despite its popularity. Now there is a name of a thinker which is hardly of relevance, because we also saw this thinker first time in the exam and the comment. So the thinker is hardly of any relevance. Now, this has two aspects, the popularity as well as controversial. Popularity, the thing is that in case of popularity, we can write the strengths also. What we can do, we are generally used to write positives and negatives. But in case of popularity, if we just write that, okay, Taylor has given this principles, these are very good applicable in industry and all. But we are writing, all of us will write these things. But are we corroborating it with some evidence? As I said, if I write Taylor's relevance and relate it to NPM, that is also known as neo-Taylorism. If I can talk about the Stakhanovite movement in Russia that was inspired by this. So I am giving concrete examples that Taylor was popular in not only the theory, the place in which he gave his theory, but to other things. And you can also add some contemporary application to it, that Taylor continues to be of importance today. O&M, recruitment, best man at the best place is still a primary requirement. Now, when I have given some evidences, like 3 or 4 evidences like this, I have corroborated the fact that he remains a popular figure. Now, coming to the controversial part. Now, as sir said, we can write a lot of criticisms there. I also wrote some of the criticisms there, that okay, he ignored the human factor. But criticism is not exactly what this question is asking. It is asking why it remained controversial. Now, this is a part of content. I was lucky because sir taught us this part, that Taylor was, because of Taylor there was a trade union crisis or trade union movement conflict, strike happened, then there was a committee of Robert Hoxie that was set up for this. So this was a kind of specific demand for this question, that yes, he ignored human factor, that you can write in some small space. In fact, what I did, I'll tell you, that I immediately wrote Taylor, and in a very small box I wrote what were his weaknesses, so that I don't miss out on some of the content that other people are writing. I wrote the writing. I wrote that also for 3-4 points in a very small box, and then I analyzed it that why it, and then I wrote I gave it a separate heading that why it was controversial, and then I wrote that because of this labor union thought that they were being forced to work extra, there were strikes and all, then Robert Hoxie committee was decided in which Taylor was called and all these things to prove that it was controversial, because this is a controversy. I also wrote this thing so that I don't leave out some content that others are writing, but in a very small space, because this was not a direct ask demand of the question. So using these things, I thought I covered the popularity angle as well as the popularity as well as the controversial angle. So in this sense, I thought I answered the questions in a holistic manner.
May I add one more thing, that this table, etc. So since last 2 years, this strategy we are trying to adopt, and they have been also adopting. So we have been teaching, be it GS paper or optional, that you draw a table in answer, either in beginning, somewhere. You also can draw like this, and you can write some facts in that. Its benefit is that it improves your presentation. Second, it somehow, let's say that it brings all those required facts which you may not be able to write in answer. So factuals can be taken care of in that small table, and then your answer will focus on analytical parts are the main parts. So then it balances both. The basics are also written, and then the demands of the questions are also addressed. And it does not take much space. And it does not also increase the number of words much, because you write the facts only, the terms are the key points only, right? And perhaps it has been working somehow, let's say that. So this is how he is talking. In fact, he is master in all these kind of presentation.
Again, for this particular question, there is another important thing that we need to look at. The question is, Taylorism is considered very controversial despite its popularity. So we know about Taylor so much that we can write 1.5 page on popularity and then just write half a page, because there are only 2 pages for regarding controversy. Now, since the question is primarily focusing on controversial and less on popularity, so you need to balance your answer. Give as much space, probably a greater space to the controversial part and less space to the popularity. Try to sum up your examples for popularity and write it in a limited manner. Control your emotions there and focus on the controversial part. Try to give more examples on that part, because that is the major demand of this question.
Okay, many people may have written more on popularity, less on controversy, right? Or let's say ki less on popularity, more on controversy. So these are all, let's say that ki skill, writing skill part, that we should understand ki what exactly, how much I should write on popularity section, how much I should write on controversy section, and then I should conclude. This is not the only question. There can be still many other questions. All questions demand certain right balancing act. That this is called balance answer. Balance answer means not to compromise your view and write a very defensive view so that you should not criticize government, etc. That is not balancing act. Balancing act means you address the demand of the question. So this is how right way to tell, or he is talking about. But I guess ki many people may not have written in this fashion. Right. Ki how much you write on popularity, how much you write on controversy, what exactly you pick up on that controversy. And this is the point, let's say that, ki which I was saying, ki you should find such some of those things which will make a difference between a person who goes on very higher level, a person who does not. That is called controversy. Why Taylor was controversy, substantiating with any major fact. Right. So are you writing that? It's not only Robert Hoxie committee, there is also US Congressional committee. Right. Both are, let's say that, both did the same thing, the committees were set up. So are you picking up those points? I am afraid that many people may not have. And they may have ended with only criticism side. This is the difference, let's say that, between the person who exactly understands the question and the person who failed to understand between lines.
Please ask questions if you have any in between whatever I'm trying to say. I'll try to deal with those questions. I'll take another example. For example, in this question, probably we may miss out on some of the concepts or some particular content that we are not aware of. For example, many people may not be aware of Robert Hoxie Committee and U.S. Congressional Committee. But now I'll come to a question in which we know the probably all of us would know the content. But before that, I'll see. I believe that it is a greater challenge to write an easier question. And lesser challenge is to write a difficult question, because if a difficult question we approach something and even if we hit far from the bullseye, examiner can think, okay, he has attempted this and written some of the relevant stuff. Effort is appreciated, as sir used to say. But if we ignore the easy questions and miss out and do not write the concrete specific points, we'll not get marks, even because their effort is of no use, because that you should know, being a public administration student.
Then examiner thinks that if the candidate cannot write this simple question,
for example, the question 2A that I attempted, the question was, Douglas McGregor's theory X and theory Y describe two contrasting models of workforce motivation applied by managers in an organization, examine. Now, all of us have read Douglas McGregor. We all know about theory X, Y, money lazy, money crazy, and how responsible workers. We all know these facts. And this is, I believe, a question that is somehow repeated, because a similar question was asked 2 to 3 years back. Is theory X and Y is only a motivation theory sort of question was there. So now, the first part of the keyword here is examine, and the question statement is clear. It describes two contrasting models of workforce motivation applied by managers in an organization. Now, here we can write, for example, I thought that if the question is demanding contrast, what best way to contrast than to show that theory X here and theory Y here, and write contrasting. For example, he assumes that workers evade responsibility. Here he says workers takes responsibility. Here it talks about dependent independence. Then here lazy, money crazy. He is not responsible kind of thing. So you can write what three to four points that we have read about theory X and Y. Here all of the content you have written, that theory X and four or five major points you have written. Now another important thing for this is to bring in some of the terms that McGregor used. How it is two contrasting models of workforce motivation? Because it is according to managerial cosmology, selective adaptation to the workers' thinking. So these are the terms that McGregor used in his theory. You are adding your content by using those terms.
In this question, the important thing is not to write this. The important thing is what thereafter he is talking about, right? Because all people will write theory X and Y, right? But that is not the demand, in the main demand of the question. The main demand is thereafter, right? But again, I will tell you that the way I know the candidates, the way they write their answers, right? On that basis, I can say you should have written one page on theory X and Y. And thereafter, some whitewash may have been done in one and the half page left.
So now, when we analyze this question, how will we say that it is a two contrasting? By using these terms, we will say that it depends upon managerial cosmology thinking, and he selectively adapts to the thinking of the worker according to what stereotype he has of the worker and the person. For example, in theory Y, he believes worker to be a responsible fellow. In theory, X, he believes it to be a dependent fellow. In theory Y, he believes it to be an independent fellow. And accordingly, he applies his own motivation theory and try to. I don't know whether sir will say I wrote it, that this is how I related it in a very small portion to the need hierarchy theory. Maslow's need hierarchy theory. To some extent, that Maslow also used it, and some portion of it was theory in a very small portion. Just to bring some sort of difference, that Maslow also, because it is also asking about theory of motivation, and Maslow specifically talks about motivation.
In fact, it is out of
very less people will know that theory X and Y is a motivation theory also. When you read in content theory, so content theory, theory X and Y is also a content theory. The theory X and Y is not only a management theory, let's say it talks about management, it also talks about motivation. So in content theory of motivation, it also comes after hierarchy and two factor and this ERG theory and theory X and Y. So in fact, it is outstanding to relate, because then you take also into consideration motivational factor, right? So this is how the interrelationships, or this is what we are saying, after writing theory X and Y, this is how the your most important thing begins thereafter. Right. And there people, I think, this is what we'll be saying, again, people will may not have done these kind of interrelationships, substantiating it.
Now, after writing these, I'll write 2 to 3 lines and say that, okay, by these factors, we can say that theory X and Y were different models of workforce motivation used by, applied by managers in an organization. Now, another important part is the keyword is examine, whether this statement is perfectly all right or not. Because this statement, I wrote it, sir, please tell me whether I wrote it right or not. It says, describe two contrasting models of workforce motivation. It is giving an impression that these are particularly describing motivation models only. So in the end, just half a page of 6-7 lines, I wrote that these were broadly management-based theories. It would not be correct to say them as contrasting models of workforce motivation. But since in any organization, motivation plays a critical role, this theory also dealt about different modes of motivation, but it was broadly a management-based theory. To conclude it, hence, it was a, in the last line you can write, it was an organization-based theory dealing with different styles of management of organization in which motivation was also an important component.
Percent of the people. Right, you can see that key one has motivation. Means first you write the theory, right? You try to give some example, it is a contrasting thing. Then you relate with the motivation, it is a motivation theory, so you compare with the hierarchy and you divide into two and three parts. And then you address the exam that key, no, it is hardly a management theory. But while dealing the management, it deals with motivation. So it is not primarily a motivation theory. And this is a very in short you write it. So you address all the answers, it is a perfect answer. Right. This is being done in on the spot, let's say that. In examination hall, you do it, it is a perfect answer. It is a perfect answer.
Though I admit it honestly that it was not on the spot, because
that you give less focus. After that, not they did not focus. I tell you that not a single class they miss. Even the new candidates who join, they miss
some of the classes.
So they miss some of the classes, but even last 3 years, let's say, we don't have in memory that they miss a single class. So as far as, let's say, that effort is concerned, so especially at home, that they may have given less this year, but that you should not take the message, because already they have given last 2 years the huge effort in public administration. So this is how the effort, still it is not an answer that how it goes to speak.
That is
sir, how did you start this question?
Did
you write
an introduction? Theory X and theory Y?
Yes, sir.
I started with this only. And then I wrote some 3 to 4 lines at theory. Yes, I first drew this. And then I started with that above presents a contrasting model of theory X and theory Y in which different components of their has been written.
Because in some cases we have already told that, you see, you can begin with a table, you can begin with certain these aspects. So this was the strategy lesson, right? Not to write introduction necessarily in literature, but you can simply draw a table or you can bring that factual direct answer. Certainly he may have written in some other answer literature based introduction, but in some of the answers this is how the strategy.
But whenever you try to whenever you draw a table in the starting, try to refer to it in the next 2 to 3 lines. It should not be a gap. When suppose you have drawn something and written something else, there should be a flow in your answer. So whenever you draw a table in the starting, try to relate this literature 3 to 4 lines to and present your argument thereafter.
Means writing 2 or 3 lines.
For example, that as I said that our presents a contrasting model. Just to give it a glimpse that I have like related to it, and then proceeded with my analysis of the question.
Yes, to answer this question about current, how you draw current, etc.
Okay. So we had since we came regularly to the class, as I said that sir used to discuss many things. So that we always tried to have like note the examples that sir was telling in the classes and write it in our notes. In addition to it. See, when you have a grasp over the concepts that we had because of sir, so we try to relate it. You should always have the syllabus at the back of your mind, whether it be GS or public administration, and the conceptual clarity that you will have because of the study that you are doing, it will help you relate. If Niti Aayog is making some changes, is talking about some reforms, it somehow will be related to public administration because this is what subject is about. It depends upon how you correlate it, how you fit it, how you use it. How you use it in paper 2, how you use it in paper 1. Some World Bank reform that is undertaking a news item of it, you can refer it. ARC you have read sometime because ARC uses NPM extensively. If in NPM you can write an example that ARC 2 has referred extensively NPM type of reforms in the report 10 personal administration, it is a good example because you have related it. So this is how you should be aware about your topics, and you should continuously try to relate whatever you are reading. Some Yojana magazine if you are reading, some current affairs that you are seeing, some video that you are watching, or some report that you are reading. And if you just relate and recall, okay, this can be used here, just go and write down in your notes that this example was there. So that you can revise it also, because unless if that is not the case, you will forget it. So this is the thing, you should be aware about your syllabus and. But whatever you read, try to produce, add it to your notes, whatever current affairs you read. So this is how over a period of say 4 to 5 months between pre and, 3 to 4 months between pre and mains, you'll get a lot of good current based examples written in your notes. Now whenever you revise, you'll get ample amount of data to refer to your in your answers. In the end, I'll also tell something about paper 2 specifically and how some notes can be added to it. Anything else related to this? No, never. We didn't have the time between pre and mains. No. I read it in 2013. I got 155 marks and then I left it. I thought read the books. Yes, sorry, ma'am. Good point. I was thinking about it. As I said, I never did it in GS papers. I never prioritized my answers. But specifically for public administration, see, what happened was in 2014 when I wrote my attempt, I wrote serially. And in those papers, question number first was such that it was most humiliating to write those answers. Because it was just filling up the pages in the starting part of your, in the first half hour when your energy is at the maximum and you are writing all the useless stuff there. Because I didn't know any of the answers of particularly for 1A, B and C of 2014 paper. So I thought I'll change my strategy in 2015. I thought I'll attend the questions I know and give them time. So in 2015, I had again a Douglas McGregor question was there. I wrote it first because I knew that. Then I prioritized my questions. Not only questions, I wrote 2A and B first, then 3B and C first, 4 or something, 6 something and something first. And then whatever was left, I wrote it there. In the remaining time, because even if I had written in the starting, I would not have been able to produce good content for them because I didn't knew them. So in my opinion, you can also follow this. Try to write those questions first that you know properly, and you can write good answers in that. Again, it will increase your chance of maximizing your numbers. Ideally, it should be, but on practical scenario, it extends. If you plan 20 minutes, it goes 25 and in the end. But optimal strategy should be devote enough time. And suppose you can also divide your time that if you don't know 10 marks question and you just want to write some stuff, for that you take out the 4-5 minutes and just give it 1-2 minutes, write anything. Devote the time to the questions that you know. Try to write in a very good manner. Please. I'm a mechanical engineer. See, that's not a very, see, today we're talking about public administration, but I'll say that I'm also an engineering graduate. Mechanical engineering was my subject. So whenever you go in your interview and you have whatever optional you have, it hardly matters. But they do expect that whatever graduation you have, you know something about it. You should be aware about the basics. If they ask me Indians, I am unable to tell anything, they'll believe that I was dishonest in my graduation. Yes. And that should not be the impression they should get out from you. If they ask about you, if they ask from you law, you should be able to tell the basics. In that way, they think you have wasted your 4 years in graduation, and just to evade from the optional that you had, you have taken a different option. It hardly matters, but you should be aware about the basics of your graduation subject. Anything pertaining to public administration first? That I was trying to tell using different things. Structuring, see, basic would be all of us know introduction, body, conclusion. This is very cliche, all of us know it. But structuring is a challenge in public administration papers, and your answer should have a flow. So what sir told us, it was also weakness in our answers, that you should, in the first 2-3 lines of the introduction, you should try to address the theme of the question. That is easy to say, difficult to practice, and most of us would not be able to do it, including me. I have written this year certain, but I don't know I have written good introduction or not. But try to address the demand of the questions. Sometimes try to use the terms in the question to write an introduction, so that the theme gets captured. One gets to know that you have addressed you have understood the question. For example, Taylorism is considered very controversial despite its popularity. You can say Taylor brought a paradigm shift in the approach of management in dealing with workers, because of which it was popular as well as controversial. Now, you know, because Taylor brought a paradigm change, you have given an address that because of these changes, controversy and popularity were there. And now these changes you have discussed in this. So you have captured the theme of the question. And then proceed. But the introduction should be small, 2-3 lines, 4 lines maximum. Don't try to waste, because that is not your content. Your content will come later. it is difficult to always come out with the theme of the questions. In sometimes, for example, if I take this question, the new public administration has seriously jolted the traditional concepts and outlook of the discipline and enriched the subject by imparting wider perspective by linking it closely to the society. This is a very long question, and to get exact theme might be difficult. So you can see again say that the NPA, the changes brought by the various changes brought by NPA brought a resurgence of sort in the field of public administration, the impact of which continues to be till date. Just we have written that it has brought something very relevant to the society and impact of which continues to be date, continues till date. So you have written a glimpse, you have written some 2 to 3 lines origins, and now you deal with the basics. Sir. I was also a working candidate. I also had less time till my first attempt when I got through in my second attempt. The thing is that these are complex books, and especially if I see my background is an engineering background, we are used to kind of hands through type of things, and it is not there in optionals like public administration. So that's why I came to sir, so that sir taught us something, the details of what the thinker said, and I read it Mohit Bhattacharya before coming to sir also, but I could not was not able to make out many of the things. Such is the complex nature of book. Sorry. I was not able to make out most of the things that were written in the book. So once sir taught us, we referred to the notes also, and we went back and read it again. Now this time it was more clear because we knew something about the basics. So it needs actually more than one reading. But we don't need to read it page by page, sir, I believe. Just many times these are topics which are of hardly relevance. For example, you don't need to read page by page. Whatever topic you are preparing, for example, chapter 1 say, try to read it from Mohit Bhattacharya, try to read it from Prasad and Prasad in that book. And read the book topic wise, don't read it page by page. In that way, you'll be able to understand more, and it will also help you save your time while preparing public administration. This is true, but I think if you practice in your test series, if you read the basic books that are there for public administration, Mohit Bhattacharya, after that vocabulary is not of that much relevance. Though some terms like interdigitizations that was used in 2014 paper will continue to horrify us, but again these are for 1-2 questions, let's leave them. So we are not like academicians, literature giants that we should be able to understand. But for public administration, I believe once you have read the book, once you have attempted your test series, once you have gone through the notes, most of the questions you will be able to understand. Yes. So if you are relating it to the Indian administration, try to relate it with the current also. Yes, do not write to relate it in the first instance related to the Indian administration, and then write a separate contemporary example. Try to club both of them. Use a contemporary public administration example. In any case, you will be using examples from administration only, because you are writing public administration papers. So try to club that, because as I said, if once you refer to the current example, it gives an understanding that you have understood the topic. Only once you have the conceptual clarity, then only you can relate.
So in
That you cannot do by sitting an hour or two. That will automatically happen once you start a habit of it in 3 to 4 months time. And maybe you cannot do it for each and every topic. This can also be. Some questions maybe you can write just common examples. Need not be like contemporary examples should be there in each and every question. But some questions will be there for which contemporary examples are best suited to address the demand of the question. You should figure out which question is according to this thing and try to write contemporary example. No need of writing contemporary example in each and every. If you can write that, good, but it will be stretching the thing. So write in the places where it demands. For example, talking about the examples, I think in last year class, sir was teaching NPM, and sir asked a question: has NPM or the NPM reform has brought changes and addressed all the problems of administration? Comment. Question was, I don't remember the exact question. But the question was, so we were writing. Sir said, shallow answer for most of us. But there was a student in sitting here. He just wrote in the starting, if NPM would have solved all of the problems, why the economic survey is saying that Chakravyuh challenge remains till date. Now, sir told us that, and we also thought, what a good example. In the starting, he has like given the message that yes, problems remain even till date, and he has referred, quoted economic survey in paper of public administration. That is how you use wide range of whatever subjects you are reading in public administration. This is not a current based example, not a from particular magazine, but just you have read economic survey, which most of us do. So he used the knowledge there and wrote it here, and what an excellent way to begin this answer. So this is how you can, whatever you are studying and in your current affairs, yes, you can use it accordingly. Sir, should I discuss some more questions? For example, now I'll take this long question that we talked about 2B. The new public administration has seriously jolted the traditional concepts and outlook of the discipline and enriched the society subject by imparting wider perspective by linking it closely to the society. Now, again, the command word here is, there are two thinkers name there, but I don't know, sir, how it is of relevance. Elucidate is the command. For elucidate command, one thing is that you have to make it clear. And how can you make things clear? By giving a proper example. So here the thing is, the question talks about has seriously jolted the traditional concepts. This is one part, and has by linking it closer to the society. So we all know that the content of this question will be knowing that it talked about five goals, three anti-goals, and traditional concepts were bureaucratic, hierarchic. So it talks about specifically being anti-bureaucratic, anti-hierarchic, and not being technical. Now it talked about flexibility, change, relevance, social change. So what is for social change? It is trying to relate it to the bringing it closer to the society. It was talking about the downtrodden sections of the society that public administration should be for them. Earlier the subject was basically research and theory oriented. This was an attempt to make it closer to the society by making it a practical thing. So these are all the content of the questions. But how to write it? So I wrote it. I wrote it again is a basic that NPM brought long lasting changes in the public administration that remains till date, something like this. Then I again specifically talked about how Golombiewski talks about this five goals and anti-goals. This is the major content for this question. So I wrote it in the starting only, again in some form tabular or something, I don't remember. Then I quoted the question that how it has jolted the traditional concepts. So I wrote traditional concepts and NPS views on that. What were the traditional concepts? Being hierarchic, being technical, and a theory-based discipline. I wrote NPA disregarded these things and said that it needs to be practical and closer to the society. It talks about the downtrodden sections of the society. And hence it linked closely to the society. And here I started with the second part of the question, how it linked closely to the society by being a practical subject that needs to, that, and now here you can bring some examples of what happened in USA at that time. That time there was a debate between the scholars that, okay, this is a, there were practical problems in administration that time, and most of the schools of thought were addressing those problems, but public administration was not interested in the practical realities that were there. Then the Hennyville education report, you can quote in very brief that it had a point, it talked about making subjects practical. So this is how you are corroborating the fact, making it clear that it was linking it closely to the society, because NPA movement is specifically started because the subject was ignoring the practical reality. That is why NPA came around, young students came to the floor and said, we want to address the problems in the society. And again, you said that NPA movement continues till date. You quote Minu Book 3 and its theme, it addresses the theme crisis governance in dark times, which is about the problems of the society, of terrorism, of climate change. This is linking it closely to the society and trying to address IT, information technology, and trying to address those problems. You can conclude by saying that. Now you have taken the entire NPA movement and tried to show how it tries to solve the problems of the society. So in this way you can write. This was more of an analytical question, so here you can prefer a paragraph-wise answer. For this, I think paragraph-wise answer would be best suited I just wrote the main content, five goals, anti-goals, Golombiewski, and some thinkers there, and wrote the basic thing there. And then after I analyzed it paragraph. So this was a simple answer, normal conventional answer. So this can be another approach.
Thank you.
if that is a must. How you condition your mind, like probably sir, you have read it the first time, Mohit Bhattacharya. So in the first, I agree to it that in the first reading of Mohit Bhattacharya, it would be difficult to address all the demands of the question. But this is how the advantage of test series and coming to a good coaching institute of getting good guidance is, once you start giving such test series, because such will be the nature of questions, either you will run or you will condition your mind that you need to think on these lines. We also thought that we should run, honestly speaking, because we are not getting good marks when we came here. But then somehow, with sir's help, we tried to thought on these lines that how answer should be there. This is basically a conditioning of 3 years, sir, in my case. So, and some, in some cases, it is also conditioning of 1 year, 2 year in our coaching institute only. So that is the thing. It happens only with practice. It is not a planned thing, sir. It will happen automatically. But it is a result of practice of say 2 to 3 years in my case. So honestly, I'll not be able to tell how it happened, but it happened over the period of time. But I'll say that it is still a better thing. You should face the tough challenge here. Yes, you should face the tough challenge here, and the eventual paper in UPSC should look simpler. If you will practice easy papers here and go to the mains paper where we have to actually score and it looks tougher, then it is hardly of any relevance. So sweat here. I'm coming. In questions of paper 2, two things are there. First, the questions seem to be from the GS paper. Honestly speaking, many of the questions are like NPA, that there are two questions related to black money and banks, NPA and all. This looks like questions from general studies paper 2 or paper 3. But the thing is that since it is since it has been asked in the paper of public administration, we need to write something from the subject itself and try to somehow bring some content of public administration it apart from writing the general studies thing, because that you need to write, because that is has been specifically asked. Now this gentleman has referred to the questions of what factors have led to the expansion of the role of Ministry of Home Affairs, how it can coordinate its affairs more effectively with the Ministry of Defence. Two parts, straight simple question. Now, what all of us can write a large number of points for the expansion of role of Ministry of Home Affairs, the increasing problems of left-wing extremism, the increasing problems of police reforms. It is still pending. The Home Affairs is the Ministry of Home Affairs is the charge. The Model Police Acts and all you can quote. The problems of disaster management. That is also that is there. Then a large number of points related to coordination with the states. Now here you bring some polity, zonal council or interstate council, in which I think the zonal council in which the Ministry of Home Affairs is the, yes. So you can use that there because ministry, you can use those examples. Now these are public administration topics that you are using them. Polity topics also and public administration. Because coordination, now you can quote here that we are in an era where Prime Minister is talking about cooperative federalism, the role of Ministry of Home Affairs seems to be on the rise. Now right, interstate council, zonal council, because that becomes relevant because they are big agents in promoting cooperative federalism. Then I wrote six, seven points for this, how left-wing extremism problem you have, as I said. Then for this police reforms, you can quote that Supreme Court is after this Ministry of Home Affairs, that why are you not this? You can also somehow use Katie Thompson committee that it asked Home Ministry to, it has commented that Home Ministry is not dealing it in a proper manner, some way like this, the Supreme Court Appointment Committee. So these are all, this is a very general GS based answer, but bringing some things like these, we have tried to like relate it to the public administration content. Now, again, as in general, you can write as the problems of the society or there is chaos in the society, as society is developing, the law and order problems, which is very essential for development administration. Bring terms like this, development administration. Although law and order is regarded as non-development work, but it is very crucial for non-development administration. You can quote some thinker also, and use it. I don't think I quoted any thinker here, but use terms like development administration. Its role becomes critical because it is a repository of law and order administration of sort in considering the state of affairs of the union. Then you can write problems of for example of Delhi, where Union of Home Affairs and UTs, where they have role. So this is an added responsibility to them. And some other things, I don't remember exactly what I wrote, but I wrote like 8 to 9 points for this, for how its role is expanding. Because it is general asking what factors have led to. You just need to write the factors. And in those factors, try to use different terms given in the syllables of ours, and you make it more specific so that it looks like a public administration answer. And how it can coordinate its affairs more effectively with the Ministry of Defense. Now here it is, here you can also refer to ARC2. For example, how Ministry of Defense ke saath, how it can coordinate its affairs more effectively with the Ministry of Defense. Now you can bring angles of BSF, some paramilitary forces, because there is always a tussle between them, that who will control BSF, Ministry of Defense or Ministry of Home, whether IPS will head it or an army person will head it. So there is a problem of coordination. Internal security is a problem that both of them are concerned. Intelligence sharing, they both have their role. So this is all GS thing you are becoming. But for good coordination, you can say two thinkers from paper one, committee by coordination, Gulik and Urvik, you said they can have a committee by coordination mechanism. Maybe not be very useful, but just to bring some content. There you can write ARC has, or many, now you can say that a proposal was there and a US in it has been done, that there has been a separate Ministry of Internal Security. Home Ministry can have a wing like that, where it can have broad-based, committee-based coordination, but what other thinkers have said. So I remember these things that I wrote. So it is basically some thinkers, some terms given in our syllabus, and writing all the GS general study stuff that we need to write in the answer to make it more public administration oriented. And using, and also Malimat committee, I wrote it here because it referred to the role of Home Ministry. It is a very old committee. ARC I used to refer to that Home Ministry function is especially increasing because the type of reforms, the structure, the different directorates it has talked about. So these all things we can use to make answers more not only GS based but also public administration oriented. So this question I.
Lack of coordination.
again, you can give example of, like, I remember I gave example of some riot in which the decision regarding whether army is to be invited, in case of disaster management, whether army is to be called. Here we also need a proper coordinated mechanism so that the time is not wasted in these critical situations. It would be harmful for administration. So again, these are the examples we can use in these questions.
Now let me add one thing. What key point was this question that it becomes a public administration answer? Then you have coordination and you relate with some classical thinkers. Because the way, let's say, equally correlated and committee, coordination by committee, coordination through ideas, coordination through hierarchy. Hierarchy is not relevant here, but rather coordination through ideas and coordination through committee, they are two relevant things. And they were among the first to talk about coordination. No any other thinker thereafter talks about the coordination, because they gave the conceptual clarity on what is coordination, which is still remains a problem in health situations anywhere in the world. In the US or India, anywhere there is a problem of coordination. So this point, when you refer in your answers to this, brings you the complexion of public administration rather than this. And the same question if you write in this, you cannot try to make anything as coordination.
So, this was the question, sir, you asked. Yes. So again, this question is there. Do you think that some of the ideals enshrined in the preamble of the Constitution remain only on paper even today? Now the command is critically evaluate. So you need to give both dimensions of it and then present your view that whether it is only on paper or not. Now, what are the some of the ideals enshrined in the preamble of the Constitution? Justice, liberty. So, what I did again, in this question, I thought this was again a proper format. I wrote, for example, liberty. How it is on paper only. Then here I challenged my own. No, it is an effective. It is being safeguarded, or it exists in reality. Here you can give example. For example, now in this kind of questions you can present very emotional optional options. For example, if you talk about social justice being one of the principles enshrined, and you can say here, quote, when Dana Manji was walking with his wife body on the ground, nobody was there to help. Where is the social justice concept? Now you are straight away, by giving a good example, you are saying that problems remain today. Farmers are committing suicide. Where is the justice? You can write some examples and you can directly say it is on paper only. But on the contrary, you can say when Dogaria coal tribals have won their land back from the government policy and the plan has been cancelled, many people are getting justice, and you can give some good examples. You are saying it exists on the papers, though there may be some cases in which injustice has been done. So you are here presenting both the arguments. You are critically trying to add, there are situations in which injustice is there. There are situations. So the keyword over here was critically evaluate. You have to give it both the arguments, and it is a truth. If there is a case of injustice, there are equal compelling cases of justice. Here you can also lie. Now here in this question, role of example was very much there, because you need to provide some concrete examples that justice is there or injustice is there. Now that can happen only by referring to the downtrodden sections of the society. So try to give good examples. Similarly, for other things related to contemporary happenings or whatever news events, I recalled and said it is a case of justice. In the end, in the conclusion, it becomes a more important thing, because it is a content part, and it is I think ideals, for different ideas that is mentioned in the preamble. In the end, I said that India is passing through a phase of transition, and we are still a developing country, and there are a lot number of challenges, and to solve the problems of justice and to live up to the ideals of preambles, we need continuous improvement. And for it, to link it just to, I say we need to continually work upon our administrative setup and reform it according to the needs of the day. Just to finish it and give it administrative kind of look, because it is a public administration paper. We need improvements in our administration to live up to the actual ideals actually mentioned in the Constitution. Yes, I am. No, critically evaluate. I am saying there are equal cases of injustice. You can also say there is injustice. But no. More or less, you will have to write. But critically means you have to be more emphatic. More appealing that no, there are equal cases. Evaluate, you can say okay, in general you can write, but when it comes critically, you have to present a concrete negative examples to prove that there are cases of injustice and injustice is there in our society, which is the case. But in evaluate, you can simply. Somebody talked about the sources. Yes, I did it like that only, and later I analyzed and then I concluded. I wrote. Yes, in this only. Table need not always be point wise. You can write content there also. 4-5 lines for each of the ideals that was there in the preamble, and then as a sort of analysis before writing the conclusion. I wrote something after the analysis also. I don't remember what I wrote there, but something I wrote, and then I wrote the conclusion what I said. No, it is not the case, ma'am. It depended upon the question. In many of the, like the Ministry of Home Affairs, very general question. In fact, I was able to, this is only when I think it happens automatically. I don't plan it, but in paper 2, I was able to say use it in a far lesser manner than what I did in paper 1. Here the questions were pretty much direct, but somehow I tried to bring some sort of variation in it, but it was to a large extent in paper 1 only. Ma'am, if I recall, you were there with me in the class also. Last year test series, so I followed search notes. In search notes, search notes 2014, 15, 16. I have 3 years notes, so I still follow my 2014 notes, and I have added whatever sir has taught us in 15 and 16 briefly, and some new topics that sir has taught us in 15 and 16. So I had that notes, I had compiled it, and I have added to them the current examples, some diagrams that I can get in those notes only. So it becomes like 50, 60 pages, 70 pages, or say 100 pages. And if in one day, since we got one day this year, we can just turn up our pages and revise 100 pages, we can see. And but many people do it in a more effective manner. What they do is that they have 5 to 6 pages, they write different chapters, different thinkers, and they just write the keywords. And they revise it a lot number of times before going to the examination and try to use the keywords. This is also a good strategy. As I said, that's when Douglas McGregor question was asked, self-adaptation, managerial cosmology, these are the terms that we can use. So now, to use them, you need to remember them. And remember them can only happen when we revise it. And we need to revise it before the examination. So I saw many people, just before entering the examination, they had these 5-6 papers notes, and they were revising it constantly on just only the terms of different thinkers and other topics given in our syllabus. And some of the facts that they had prepared. For specifically for paper 2, I will say that we should not think that these are very general things and we will be able to write it. It is true that we will be able to write 2.5 pages on any of the topic given in paper 2. No, yes, I told about the sources of paper 1. In paper 2, then I'll tell you. So paper 2, that I followed search notes. Read some portion of Rajni Goel Arora, but very limited, first note just, added it to the current affairs, the current affairs portion. What I did, I had a collection of ARC, we have read ARC very extensively, especially the 4th, 5th, 6th and the 10th report. These are of very, huge importance for public administration. Then we had compilation of different committees, a lot number of recommendations that sir used to give us in the class, and some from net, like Malimath, Venkat Chalaiya, Sarkaria, Punchi, for training, recruitment, Kiran Agarwal committee. These are all the things that we had compiled. So these are of very huge importance in paper 2, because you can make your answers more specific, generate more content, and give good conclusions by referring to the what suggestions or recommendations these committees have given. And it is basically, these committees are for what? These are for administrative reforms, and administrative reforms is a chapter itself in paper 2, and direct questions from this committee can also be asked. So this was all I did for paper 2. Paper 1, sir, I have said it earlier, that Mohit Bhattacharya, Sir's notes, and again whatever, and something that when there are various topics in part 1 of the syllabus, for that we did that we typed it on the net and got some good, very good documents for it. For example, NPM type of reforms, and especially the part 1, which is chapter 1, which is very dynamic, and a lot number of diverse questions have been asked from it. We can get some very good content on it, especially some World Bank reports, only 15-20 pages, in which only 5 to 6 pages have to be read. Some I had a collection of some reports like these on Chester Bernard, on Foley. They analyze it and they give their contemporary applications. So you can also, it's a manner of preparation also. You can get to know how they can be related to the current happenings. But this should only be done once you have a basic level of preparation. I did it on my third and fourth attempt. So, because I had some basic knowledge of public administration after 2 attempts. Online sources is this only what I was telling, searching some good PDF documents on various topics listed in our syllabus, especially in IGNU. I never referred. I saw it for public policy, I saw it for public policy, but it was not of much relevance. Sir teaches public policy extensively, because it is a portion that we miss out. Public policy, nobody teaches it in a detailed manner. The growing prominence of NGOs in development areas is strongly related to the declining legitimacy of the state. Explain. Now, why it is happening? That is a news. You can use this example in an effective manner, but that is not of the central importance of this. I will tell you how we can use this example. In my opinion, see, the growing prominence of NGOs in development areas strongly related to the declining. You can simply say that state machinery is not there in many parts of the country, especially in the hinterlands. What you can provide very good examples in case of left-wing extremism, where NGOs are more close to the people than state. They don't trust state as much as they trust NGOs. Then in case of physically disabled, mentally disabled children, NGOs are doing far better work, because state work is not there, and hence NGOs are gaining prominency. Now you can use some figures smartly. Because of the gaining prominency only, there has been a huge growth in the number of NGOs. If there would not have been the case, why so much NGOs would have come? So they are getting support from foreign institutions, because they are doing some good work from charitable institutions. So they are getting prominency because state is receding ground for them. State is not able to provide enough services from them. Now you can bring in governance aspect here. That is why the concept of governance also tries to incorporate both state and NGO, because both are complementary. Where state is unable to reach, and it can take help of NGO to reach to that place. You can also say, what example you gave, that is why probably you can see a sort of clamp down on NGOs, because it is gaining more relevant, it is getting more attention, people are trusting them more. Many of the personalities of NGOs, say good example, they are getting Magsaysay Award because of the social work they are doing. So just to give a good example. So the basic things is like that only. And you can, declining legitimacy of the state, you say land acquisition, you take example. And you say example of Jal Satyagraha, where NGO took place and it went on to march and brought the state on its feet, and Mr. Jairam Ramesh, the then union minister, asked them to give them their land back. So this is again, these NGOs are gaining space over the state. Some examples you can use. I don't remember much on this answer. These are the general pattern of this answer. Yes. This is a really difficult question. We didn't study with so much of planning, but I'd say that just to give basic, we followed sir test study test series schedule. Whatever tests were there, chapter wise, we tried to cover those chapters. And since we were aware of the entire, first you need to read the entire syllabus. And this interlinking of thinkers, interlinking of concepts happens at the preparation stage only. Once you are clear of the concepts, you have read the first concept and you are reading second thing. You have read Fayol, you are reading now Bernard, you can relate whether Fayol is related to Bernard. So that happens at the preparation stage itself. Now once you, we followed sir test series schedule, so whatever chapters were there, we revised it. We got whatever current we needed to there. We read some reports that was needed to be read and compiled the data and tried to give test. Now this was the easy part because you read three chapters and come. But to revise it and to give the whole mock test is a big challenge which will happen in examination. For that, I think again the notes making thing is a very critical component. Try to write in some probably in brief manner what all you are reading. Because only then it will be of any relevance. Otherwise you will, the human mind is such, we'll forget it because we are reading a lot number of things. In very small one line, two line, a crux of what we have read, a good example, a news report, just quote a news report, I read it on this day so that you can revise it. Because then only your wide range of reading will count, will come into picture. You need to relate it, you need to remember it also. Yes, that you need to do for revision, that I said the keywords. But also whatever examples you are trying to relate, you should write it somewhere, otherwise you will forget it. And you should make all this, this will not happen automatically in the examination until we practice it a lot in a test series. We should practice whatever we are planning to do in our mains examination in the test series itself. Because mind should be conditioned so that it comes out automatically there, because there we are under a lot of stress. Here we write it very casually, go and have a cup of water and then come, but there it is under, we are under huge stress. So mind should be conditioned so that it comes out automatically, and that will only happen when you write a lot number of tests and do it very sincerely. So this is the basic strategy.
Sir, as this discipline is not having a clear delineated boundary and borrowed from many disciplines, what is the suggestion for those who do not phone or due to some reason do not come to the coaching in Delhi? How they prepare by themselves?
Sir, recording is also there nowadays. This you can, net penetration on net is good enough, I think you can get it from there. Now sir is available across the length and breadth of the country. So people can get access to it. But I believe that I have done it from coaching, many people have done it on their own. Many people have different calibers, they can do it on their own. But I do believe that not getting good guidance in public administration is a kind of negative thing for your preparation. I sincerely don't know how to help them, but I think this is a good innovation, it can help. Sir's recorded video is there on your stencil if you want to get access to it in, say, Gujarat, Ahmedabad. I have told many people myself, they have told to, they have told me that they will not be able to come here in Delhi. I said, okay, get Sir's online videos. And Sir is also, I think, online test series also there. Online test series was also there. So you can get both.
All programs,
in fact, are online.
In the 20 marks question, approximately how many words answer will be? In 20 marks questions, how many words, like 200 words, 150 words?
Generally, 250, 300 words. This home ministry portion was a little longer because there are a number of points that we can write. But
you want to use 200 all the questions?
Yes. Because we need to write the entire paper. Even if you don't know, you need to write something.
Can we get some of your answers?
That I think sir has already put it on our website, Lukmaan IAS. There are some copies there. I actually have kept copy in my home. I'll get them back here and get it because we never knew that it would be useful. So I'll bring it back and hopefully scan it and put it online.
Since we do not scan all the copies when test is going on, we scan only those good copies. Already he has, in fact, 2015-16, already he has copied, many copies have been given to the people, those who wrote test programs. Because he used to write, in fact, he is a prolific writer, this is what he said. I say in this way. Already at least 2-3 copies are on the website. There is a link if you go on the website. There are many other copies. You can see his copies.
I will add to it that just don't see the copy of mine because I have got a rank. There are many good people who write excellently. They have also very good style, a different style. You can also learn from that. It's only UPSC's irony that many people are not there in the list. Let's ignore it, but we can learn from that also. I think sir will be putting on some of other copies.
Those copies will also be put in, those you have not made to this list, but they are also equally good. They may be in future making the list. And when copy we are talking, so she was also asking why it's endeavor, etc. If you see his answer, it's, again, there is no one way to write answer, either only in points, either only in paragraph, or only tables, etc. This is not. Answers should be, again, natural. It is mix of all. The demands of the question. If it demands to write analytically, it should be analytical. If it demands to write some facts, some points, there should be some points. If you want to illustrate, make it good presentation, there should be there. So it's not like there should be only points, or there should be only paragraph. This is not the case. So in fact, even when you want to see his copy, you see how he writes. There are at times points also, there are paragraphs also, there are tables also. Again, you do not find tables in each and every answer. It's not you have to make table in each and every answer. This is also not the case. Otherwise, again, it becomes artificial.
These all table and diagram can be used, but content remains to be the most important part. Many
yes.
people have done nothing of this sort. And
don't
just
take from this class scheme only I have to make. Tables, etc., and he makes tables, etc., so that's why he has been able to secure content is the most important part.
Many people have just written good content and got good marks also. That is also truth.
Yes. We remember, if let's say that we talk a very old story of old era, so say third line.
Yes, someone.
Yes. Not a single diagram or table you will find in his answer. Right. But he secured 390. 90. So it's not about, let's say, that making tables, etc. This you should not carry in your mind. It is, I am liking, that's why marks do not matter. Most important thing is content. What content? Whether you are writing in NPA question, how it brought society, means administration, closer to society. This is called content, whether you are writing. Whether you are writing why Taylor was controversial, you draw a very good table, you write all principles, etc. Suppose you do not write why he was controversial. So, no marks will be given. The other examiner will get irritated. Because answer should not be beautiful, it should be content. So, content is the most important aspect, but along with content, if we can make it better in presentation, so why not? This should be the
question. Sir, what are the public administration? No question. Public administration. Just the question why you chose your optional as public administration. I said that I was already working when I thought of giving this examination. Mechanical engineering was my other choice, which was very difficult to prepare while I was working. I could read this subject while I was traveling and all other things. So I had the time and I also liked this subject. So I started with public
administration. For the working angles, like how did you get time? Is it, was it for time or like you
Worked
in
I basically gave prelims from where I was working and came here after the prelims exam each time.
Okay, for 2-3 months and then?
Yes.
So we should finish. Yes. All the best.
Thank you.